Get started. Our second speaker is Eliseo Chen from Barcelona, and he's going to be telling us about emergent gauge theories and certain computer systems.
First of all, thanks for the organizer for the invitation and building up this very nice multidisciplinary conference or meeting or workshop. And here I say that attach more to the word simulation, because in my thought, tensor network will go and together and also support quantum simulation. But we heard also yesterday that the two efforts are quite joined and try to go beyond what can be done with Monte Carlo. And also have the impression that both, as we understood also in the talk of Ignacio, both tensor network, but also the attempt of try to quantum simulate something will now force us to try to see how we can rearrange the theory to make it easier and also help us to understand it. I don't go reach holography, but there is in this talk essentially some form of duality, but the duality is just the electromagnetic one. So it's something more simple. So, this is Università Autonoma in Barcelona, but actually moved there in January, and this work is usually been done while I was in Innsbruck. It's still work in progress, so you don't find anything on the archive. I hope to put it soon. This was delayed by the movement. But okay, so this I change a bit. Here, some other target would be to have a quantum simulator, and perhaps most of you heard about Rydberg, others not. So, what are these Rydbergs? So Rydberg are a very wonderful system for essentially are one of the best possible choice for simulating spin model. And these are just a picture from group around, but more than giving you a lot of detail, I would like to stress a property that Rydberg has that is a property. So roughly speaking, what is a Rydberg atom? It's just an atom that you excite to a very high level. The fact that you excite the electron to a very high level makes the it to have a huge dipole. So there's if you put two Rydbergs far away, the two atoms excited at a very high level, they interact strongly as one of the six, and this makes them perfect to be modeled with a long range interaction. But as it was shown in this marvelous recent paper that famous because it's a quantum simulator of 51 qubits, probably one of the largest available now. The idea is that the main property of this Rydberg is a very simple one. So if I put two atoms close by, if they don't interact, they don't see each other. So I may drive my transition with the laser back and forward between this level, but if I put one of the two in the river state, this produces a strong electric field that produces shifting energy, and this shifting energy block the transition, so the transition becomes of resonance. From the point of view of the mathematical point of view, it just means that we have a stronger nearest neighbor potential. I can think this as a spin model, so this is spin up, for instance, and this is spin down. And essentially, this potential is just spin-spin interaction. And what this potential is doing, if I want to study perturbation theory, when this dominate, I go in the rotating frame, and essentially, I can see that I can oscillate only in the regenerate subspace. And this just means that I get this kind of dynamic that means that this spin can flip only when the neighbor is in a spin up, both neighbors are in a spin up. So this very simple observation that has been realized in experiments allows to study a lot of interesting phenomena, and also phenomena that are interesting for thermalization. Maybe you heard about one. I have no time to enter about it, but there is a strong connection with gas. But my claim is that if we, and this is somehow the summary of the talk, would be that if we take now an array of 2D Rydberg atoms. So this now is something that there are already possible, and there are more and more groups that are doing that. We can really, just using this natural repulsion, we can get a system just by arranging the distance between these atoms that produce an emerging Gay lattice case theory. And this Gay lattice case theory actually arises when we recognize it, when we rearrange the degree of freedom that essentially we do it by. And as I say, the tensor network approach is what we use to understand whether this to test the benchmark or not. No realization to test if all this construction is working. Well, this is more or less to give the idea of the construction. So I will start from a motivation that's somewhat obvious why we want to study Gay's theory is strongly interacting theory, and these are interacting both from high energy physics but also for surface matter. Then I will somehow do what Ignacio did, but more from the point of view of a simulator. So what does it mean from the point of view of the simulator to build a gauge theory? So you more or less it's exactly the same construction you would think for tensor network, more or less. And then I will go through a specific case of special formulation of gauge theory that connect directly to quantum matter, that is timer model or Oxford-Hamilton model. And then I will speak about the challenge in the implementation, that somehow also the challenge that we have in tensor network, because most of the interesting physics arise when we go to 2D with magnetic interaction, and these interactions are very hard to get in a simulator, as they are quite hard to simulate by and then finally I go to the new part that essentially I will rewrite, show that this theory can be rewritten in a way that resembles this physics of Rydberg blockade, and then I will just explain how we actually plan to implement it, and also the benchmark we did to some extent. So let's go for the motivation part. Okay. Here probably it's not needed to convince you that Gay's theory are very important and are everywhere in particle physics, but also they are emerging quantum matter and we are in the most of the most fascinating phenomena, quantum magnetism, IPC, activity that are related and topological. But essentially, the idea is that the singlet that arises in this material show an emergent Gay's theory. Okay. So we know indeed that Wilson had the marvelous idea of studying QCD with the lattice, because it allowed the non-perturbative formulation, and as we heard a lot of time these days, indeed this is extremely successful as static property. But there's problem with related to same problem in the sampling, so we have problem with the dynamics and we have problem when we have too many frames. And then, as we had also the colloquium yesterday, this essentially called for new methods. And these two methods are tensor network, as we stress, but also together with quantum simulation. And I would say that the two are deeply related, because essentially, if we take now an Hamiltonian approach, that as Ignacio said before, essentially what we are doing, we are constructing an auxiliary quantum matter system in that produce an emergent Gay's theory. So we can or study numerically with tensor network, or try really to build a system that has the same dynamics, or try to engineer the same dynamics, and then just measure this system to get the result. And somehow the interplay between the two approaches is quite good, because one after another, there is also an empty competition. Okay, so how we want to build this in practice, this theory. So since quite some year, there's been a lot of interest in success, for instance, this called Atom, in engineer what is called synthetic gauge field, it is just a classical external gauge. So one is taking just the Hamiltonian formulation of a lattice gauge theory. We take this as a classical field. So what we have just atoms that hop around with some faces, and it is we add up these faces, we get essentially a magnetic flux. If we make these faces change in real time, we get an electric field. Now, if we want really to study Hamiltonian lattice gauge theory, we, as we heard also from Ignacio, we should promote among this field to be quantum, that this is equivalent to ask for some matter living on the limb that represent the gauge field. And then we have this the Wilson operator that did become an operator that has the right commutation relation. It's the conjugate variable, say, of the electric field. And then if we have also to put the dynamics for this gauge field, that in this case will be just an electric term plus the magnetic term. So this is exactly the parallel thing to what you get in approach, but just in an operator. Now I will because at the end the idea is that we obviously we would like to be able to simulate at the end this field, but we want to start with a simple example. For instance, we said to the QED, but the beginning can be interesting also. I forgot, sorry, this is a crucial point. I forgot that indeed we should ask that our theory respect gauge invariance, and then this means that we should ask that our gauge field respect the Gauss law, that just means that the divergence of the lattice of the electric field. So this will select some of the possible gauge field computation. But as I was saying, we can take a further simplification in our approach and study the limit in which the matter, the charged matter, has infinite mass. So this is essentially a static matter. And this limit is still interesting because it allowed us to probe, for instance, static probe charges if we are confined or not. And then if we do this approximation, we'll end up just with a pure gauge theory. That we'll have only matter, the matter degree of freedom are just bookkeeping for telling us which gauge field are allowed, but all the dynamics is on the gauge. Okay. As in the tensor or in tensor network or in quantum simulation, now if we want to simulate this, we have to do some sort of location, because this quantum here would be infinite because the electric field is not bound. So we should truncate it in some form. But actually, what one can treat it as really as a spin state. And the minimal choice is what is called the gauge magnet or link model. It's just taking the gauge field as a spin monad. In principle, the theory we get is a theory that can have a different physics than the original QED. So this emerged also yesterday in the discussion. But from the point of view of our goal to understand how to simulate gauge theory, this is an interesting play model or playground study. And also one should observe that if applied in the non-Abelian case, what is called a dimensional regularization, so one is acting extra dimension, combat extra dimension. Actually, the theory, this gauge magnet go back to the original Kropotkin formulation. But for the moment, the subject of the talk, we will discuss just this theory. So this theory, what we have, we said the electric field is just a spin. So we have a spin monad, and the electric field is just the sigma z. So the electric field square is trivial, and what we get is a theory essentially that has only plaquette interaction, but these plaquette interaction are not commutative due to the truncation. So it's a simple theory, and furthermore, what we get is we have the Gauss law, and now this Gauss law has a quite transparent meaning, in a sense that we have to impose that this combination of the sum of the magnetic the oriented sum of the the magnetization around the site should match with the charge. So let's look to this theory in more detail. So let's start from understanding which kind of configuration are allowed in this. So as we said, the gauge field is just represented by sigma, and we could use instead the color of the graphic notation, in which if the spin is up, we color it red. If the spin is down, we don't color it. And now we go to representing this law here, and for simplicity, I choose the case when the mass is zero. And what we get out is V6 configuration. This indeed is what for the expert is the famous Sitz-Perkles model. And indeed, this relates also to what Frank was telling us. This indeed is what we get for the planar eyes, where now the value of the spin is essentially related to the allowed position of the hydrogen. This was a very old observation. And now all the gauge invariant field, so all the gauge field configuration that respects the Gauss law are just constructed with this building block, and this somehow match with what Ignacio was saying, that physical states somehow have a natural tensor network structure, if you like, because you can choose this configuration and put that at a big corner. But from the graphical point of view, you see this, if you look here, all these configurations are just configurations with these red strings are just going up or right. So we just visually we can say that if the configuration is allowed or not when you have no charges. This is one of the possibilities. So somehow we have fixed now which are the possible state, and now we want to see the dynamics. So if we look to the to the operator before, which was the Planck operator, if you write it down, essentially what this operator is doing is just taking corner of this kind and is flipping them while it's annihilating all the other states. So essentially what it's doing is really making the string moving on this corner, but only the corner we can turn, only the corner we can flip, while this term is zero on the rest, so it's doing nothing. So you may wonder what is the meaning of this kind of kinetic term. In fact, one could redefine just slightly the rename the spins, and we could convert this corner flipping in a parallel, in a diamond move in which we change parallel times. And this somehow it's make evident that this theory has something to do with quantum dimers. So let's see very shortly what are quantum dimers. So if we have an anti-ferromagnet, the electron there at low energy, essentially the whole energy theory described by, so the electron tried to bounce in its singlet, the valence bond electron. And so what we get, the low energy theory should be described by valence bond coupling. Now these singlets are not essentially orthogonal, but this singlet configuration in the thermodynamic limit treat as really just dimers that are essentially orthogonal, and singlets exclude one another due to monogamy on entanglement. We get that essentially this arcor dimer exclude one another, in a sense on a side an electron can be bound only to another electron, so there are no dimers that depend on just one dimer end on its side. And then quantum fluctuation is argued that what it's doing, it's allowed that is emerging perturbation theory. And this was work of Anderson or Iverson and many other people. Essentially, would drive to a quantum superposition, would move these dimers, and one of the simplest dynamics you can imagine is just to exchange the position, and this still respects the arbor condition, because this is allowed only if you respect the arbor condition. And so this idea was this quantum fluctuation should give resonating by phone, creating configuration of this one. But in the language of before, this is really Gauge theory in the sense that this becomes a Gauss law. And we can just make a map to show us the defining with the spin. So we assign a spin one out to having the diamond or not in the same fashion as before. And we go back to the previous. So what we learned somehow that this gauge theory, this symbol gauge theory, has to do with, it's interesting because it's a toy model of high energy gauge theory, but also is interesting in condensed matter. And the most interesting or simplest model of this quantum dimers is what we call this Roxhill-Hilson model. That essentially we have just the magnetic interaction, so this is the Plaquette interaction, and we add to this interaction the square of it. And what is the meaning of adding this term? This play the role of a chemical potential, because remember what I was telling you, this term just flip the corner, this corner in this direction, and this one what it's doing is just counting the number of corners we have. So this is essentially counting the number of flippable plaquettes and the act as a chemical potential, and this term is sufficient to get a very nice phase diagram that has been studied with several methods. And just giving you an idea of what is going on in this model, if we take lambda that is going to infinity, so obviously minus infinity, we are going to favor the configuration in which all the states are flippable, and this was called normally mean order. And now if we just increase lambda over zero, this state essentially it's dressed but remain the same, and this is an example of ordered by disorder. Then if we increase this over zero, a certain point essentially we have this term is not there any longer, and so we get what we expect. So we get superposition of strings, and these strings, this superposition as a resonating valence bond form, but actually this become, as you will know, become a solid, because being a superposition of singlets, this is not breaking a rotation invariance, but is breaking a translational invariance, because as I was trying to picture with this cartoon, this oscillation are in phase on the two sublattice for separate. So this somehow, this is resonant, they resonant in phase, but it's not in phase with the other one. And this order somehow break translation invariance. And then we get, this was somehow why this model was constructed. By construction, if we put lambda equal one, this becomes the sum of projector, the square. And then one can show that the state that is just a superposition of all the Laud configurations, of all the physical states with respect to the Gauss law, and we take an even superposition of them, this is a state of energy zero. So this is essentially a toy model of a resonating valence bond, breaking any symmetry, but this state is scalar, so this somehow it's like an isolated liquid. And then if we ramp up this lambda further, we get a background that is not flippable, in a sense that what is called the columnar phase, because the system in a sense pay too much price for having a flippable configuration, so it's sitting in configuration where the kinetic energy essentially is. Okay, so this is more or less the model. So I hope I convinced you that in this idea that we want to go towards being able to simulate high energy physics, we can stop on these models, and this model is relevant also for quantum matter. So we want to construct a quantum simulation of a physical system that reproduces this Hamiltonian. And this has been the main problem, as you may understand, is that it's quite hard to get an interaction of this kind, because we have to entangle spin that first been simultaneously at distance, and at the same time we should respect this this law. Obviously, this problem is studied, and there are two possibilities. One possibility is an analog approach. So the idea is to get the Oslo from energy penalty and the Plaquette interaction interpretatively, and this was studied in this group. And this, in a sense, the problem from the simulation point of view is that this kind of term are really small, so the system becomes very sensible to imperfection, what in our experimental term normally is said as temperature, so it's really hard to assess this phase in the real system. Another possibility is what we studied with Luca and Maciek some time ago, is that somehow it's the counterpart of it. So using a digital simulation, now the idea is that instead of doing the Plaquette interaction as perturbatively, as exchanging particles around the Plaquette, the idea is that we decompose this this dynamics in sequence of rotation. We could get the Gauss law using dissipation or by energy penalty. But again, all this is in principle possible experimentally, but it's quite challenging from a experimental view. If you want, a quantum computer would follow exactly this this route, but quantum computer are a bit still hard to do. So the point is, can we do something better with this Plaquette interaction? And this is the second part. We start the new part of the talk. So we said, okay, we have this this Hamiltonian. We would like to get into the lab. So how we could do? We have seen that this the obvious elementary object of the Plaquette itself, because this Plaquette interaction is just flipping when it acts, take this Plaquette state and interchange between them. So this looks like a spin 1/2. But there are also all the other states that are filled by this this Plaquette operator, and also we should ensure that we get the Gauss law. So how we can get then the dual formulation of this theory, which we express really as a spin model of Plaquette, taking into account that these are not commutative. So the simplest way to turn around this problem is to say, I take a suitable reference state, and then I apply my Hamiltonian, and I see all the states I can assess. And by doing this, I construct my dual formulation of the theory. So let's see how we do it. So the obvious state to start with is a state in which all Plaquette are fit. So it's like these stairs, parallel stairs. And then you see directly you can exchange all of that. Then I can arbitrarily call this state as a ferro state, so I associate a spin up to all the Plaquette. And now I decide that when I apply a Plaquette operator, so I change this configuration from here to here, I could keep this section by putting the spin down. So I define this, the result of the operation at the spin down. And what I see that, okay, I get this operation, but all the market gray Plaquette are not flippable any longer. Because you see, they have an odd number of states, so they are annihilated by the Plaquette operator. So the Plaquette operator is something that once you flip the Plaquette, you blockade all the other states. But well, this is all in the sense that if you do it when you are far away, this is still true. But now if you start turning around all the Plaquette around the given one, what you do essentially, you reverse completely the state. The red, you exchange the red and the black on this one. So this Plaquette become flippable again. So this means that this Plaquette action is like a flip that blockade the neighbor, but also is allowed also when you are flip or all the rest around the code. So once we have understood that this is all the what the dynamic is doing when we start from our reference state, what we can do, we can take our original sync state and we can map to the dual spin. But once we have a dual spin representation, we know how to get it, because this is just telling us that this is was the original vacuum where we just flip the spin, that means we apply the placket operator there, we can go back to the original state. So what we establish, essentially, we have rewritten in this in the physical base of placket, our Hamiltonian, and what look as a quite ugly term around so placket operator is getting to a term that is also quite ugly, because involving five spins simultaneously, but it's simpler in a sense that it's just a spin flip that is allowed only if my all the neighbor are up. This is just a projector of all the neighbor up or all the neighbor are down. And actually, this construction can be also extended to other lattices and also to the presence of the ground charges. Here, I assume that there is no charge in the bulk, if you like, by fixing it the ground, I fix the boundary condition. I decide, if you like, a distribution of charges. If the system is in limited, I can say that this is my background. So, question, comment? In principle, I can do also for the other one. Because why I get this blockade? This blockade comes from the fact if I take the view that this is just a truncation of the U1 gauge theory, why I get this blockade? I get this blockade because why I cannot flip? Okay. Because when I flip, essentially I'm increasing the electric field of the link by one. See. But now I put a truncation, so the terms that are above my truncating threshold are eliminated. So if we do, for example, truncate to three states, so spin one, here we get a projector that essentially is projecting on the state apart the one that reached the value of the electric field of two. So this can be extended, but become a bit more complicated. So somehow become more like the you can flip. Here is you can flip when you have this configuration. In that sense, you can flip almost always apart few configuration. So it's the projector become a bit more complicated, but in principle it's the same mechanism. So essentially what is telling us that this model is frustrated, but the frustration comes only from this truncation, and in this dual base, it's just represented as a projector. For the aspect, this is just electromagnetic duality. If this would be U1 with the full untruncated state, this somehow would be just the rotor itself. So all the plaquette would commute, but the non-commutativity is come from the fact that we truncate, but this is just okay. So, but this makes this model still complicated, entangled, and
One to take the spin to infinity, right? Oh, so
we in okay. If I want to take contact with QD, yes, I should. QD is the one that has a spin to infinity. In principle, we don't need to go to infinity. So it means that we are studying this kind of problem, and we also discussed also yesterday. Somehow, if you fix a certain coupling, you will be able always to truncate the electric field to a finite number of states. The point is that this finite number of states you have to take will move to your coupling. So if you go towards weak coupling, since these states are in the electric basis, if you are a strong coupling, you will need just very few electric states. So this is strong coupling is still a good description of the full field. But if you go towards weak coupling, you will need to add more and more. But here we are not strictly interested in doing this. We are interested in this model because this model has a proof of principle that we can study a model with packet interaction, and also in the connection to the interest of this model to condensed matter. So this is more or less the area. Okay, so let's go to the model that I used before. So you see, once you establish that the Blackett operator has this form, since this is a square, but the square of the projector time spin flip is just the projector, so the Rapsack Hewelson takes this super form. So here it's even more evident that this becomes the meaning of a chemical potential. So what are the phase I was telling you before? By construction, this this nil phase is essentially become a ferrostate in this spin model. The resonating valence bond is again a super is essentially singlets, but that are going in a sense that the superposition spin, but the correlation are only going in the sublattice. While the columnar state is a state in which essentially all the Plaquette states are blocked, that means that you cannot find configuration in which this all spin that are also surrounded by spin that are the same orientation. There is always one that is in the wrong place. And okay, so the most interesting phase obviously is the entangled phase, because these are product state phase. So how we can detect and understand this this phase from the point of view of the dual phases? So this can be essentially detected by a simple structure factor. And here is indeed where the EMG, but this is something is not so professional, can do much better. We wanted just to check and understand that everything is fine in this theory. And essentially, there is the resonating valence bond phase is signaled by the when the structure factor in the Z, so the sigma Z correlation k in Fourier transform k 0 and k pi become the same. This is really the region which this spin lipid emerge. This red line is a potential energy. So which is this potential energy? Here I told you that we are constructing all the states that are accessible in all the physical states of the gauge theory, and we are constructing them selecting one background and then see all the graph we can generate. But if we do the MRG in this dual space, we have to be careful that the MRG, when we are doing the sweep, is not going out of this space. So we have to put an energy penalty to keep in the right manifold, and actually what we see is that this energy penalty is always zero in this phase, while here we get essentially a finite value, because in order to assess the non-flippable phase, we create at minimum two defects. This is, if you like, is the order parameter between the resonating valence bond and the column. So we have good order parameter that also would be accessible in experiment. There is also another strong observation that here I don't plot, that actually one see that in this region correlation sigma z correlation become very similar to sigma x correlation. That is essentially the fact that this is a resonating valence bond, so it's not breaking the rotations. Okay, an important point. So we have this piece that somehow is a new piece if you look from the in a blockade perspective, because this, if you remember what I told you at the beginning, in principle the Rydberg atom would produce this term naturally by interaction, but this term would be not there. But this term is crucial to assess the resonating valence bond phase, because it's the one that restores charge conjugation, that in this dual basis is just flipping the spin of one sublattice. And so if we don't put this term, we cannot assess this phase. And indeed, this can be checked, because if we restrict now our system just to a ladder, and this ladder means that essentially we cannot flip it has been round, so the only term possible is that we flip just when the neighbor, both neighbor are up, so this really of the form of the PXP dynamics on Richter chain. And but if we do the study the same phase diagram as before, we see that there is no signal of resonating valence bond solid, that it is replaced by a disordered phase. So somehow there is no relaxation. The nice thing is that this has been already realized experimentally, and the fact that there is this duality in this form was already noticed quite long ago in this paper by Morgan. So somehow we need to go to 2D to have this system, but the simplest way in which we could go to 2D is imagine that we do a cylinder and then we start try to see which is the minimal cylinder we could get. That is essentially a cylinder with two sides, that is nothing more than a periodic ladder. But on a periodic ladder, if we do the dual, it's still a periodic ladder, and now just means that this the neighbor in both directions at this point is just the other point. So if we have this, the projector that has four spins, automatically it just becomes a projector with three, where these are the, just the neighbor on the left. So if you like, with this duality, we can approximate the full 2D going in a very string cylinder on just the spin on the ladder. But we see that in this base, and then these are just a bit bigger, we can go to much larger system. We can indeed check that the same feature I was telling you is there, so that the structure factor in for 0,0 and pi coincide. And so we have there the resonating balance bond phase. The boundary of the transition on this side are affected, is not because it's point, but about it is the similar physics. So when we increase the number of points, we would go we would converge quickly to the quite quickly to the real to the case that it, this trick was used by the recent DMRG calculation of Montanger and Dalmonde, which they did they were using it in the original okay, so somehow I told you, okay, we have this case theory. We notice that there is this duality, and we notice that there is similarity to the Rydberg blockade physics. So we can, in principle, try to construct this 2D lattice case theory with plaquette interaction in the lab, but we have to sort out how getting this piece. So the lesson from blockade, what we was that to get the blockade term arises from nearest neighbor interaction that project us on a certain subspace, and only in this minimal energy subspace we are allowed to make the thing. And it's the competition, in a sense, and this determines the model. So what we should find, we have also this term, we should find proper nearest neighbor fishing interaction that just single out as low energy state, the state in which we have all the spin, all the neighbor up, and all the neighbor down. As I told you, this in principle can be generalized to other lattices that we must care about. So, to make it simple, let's study to this case, that this is somehow the minimal example in which we get a resonating valence bond solid. So we have a cartoon of the full 2D. So, what we want, essentially, we want to be able to tailor our teasing interaction on a ladder of this form. And realize this with Rydberg. So, first of all, the first problem we want, so we want to get some spin that interact in the right way. So we cannot use directly the as before the two level of the Rydberg atom, but we have to use some composite system. So in this all this mess here just means that if I take two atoms and I just assume that these two atoms have just two levels, the ground state and the Rydberg level. If we shine some light that is more energetic than the transition, what we see to convince that what you get essentially is that the low energy state, the only state that can be realized in this system, are states in which one atom is in Rydberg and one not, and the other way around. Because if you are here, this state somehow is shifting energy, so the ground is too energetic because we are shifting the transition, and the having two Rydberg states close by is highly cost a lot of energy because they have a standard function. So this means that in this regime we can get an effective spin just by putting two Rydberg close by, and this somehow is formed like a dipole because you see we have the spin having all the Rydberg on the left, on the right, and in principle we can decide to put this spin, these pairs in our lattice in any direction, and by doing this we tune the effective interaction between the spin. So what I'm saying is that to get this ladder, what we have to do is just decorate having this decorated Rydberg array, which we have essentially these dipoles that lie horizontally. Why? Because essentially what I was telling you, we want that to make able for this transition, we want that when we set, for instance, up means that we have the Rydberg just on the left and the ground on the right, we want to be able to, we want essentially that these two configurations have the same energy, because we want to exchange them. We want that essentially the same is true when all the Rydberg are on the right, but this, if we put this dipole horizontally, this we get essentially by symmetry. And so the only thing we have to do, we have just to tune this distance with respect compared to the distance between them to get exactly that all this potential shift can cancel out. So, okay, this is what we should get, and we don't only want this, we want then all the other configurations. So if we start to reverse in the order here, these instead are lifting energy, so that these are not belonging to the low energy state. So essentially this, if we have the wrong spin, the configuration enable, we cannot. And this can be done, and this essentially is not affecting our possibility of getting the resonating valence. This is not the MRG, it's EP, because it's easier to do in time evolution. In principle, one could do it with the MRG, but we wanted just to check that all this, the approximation indeed is consistent. So we essentially initialize the Rydberg on the right, then we just turning on the adiabatic evolution, we turn on the coupling smoothly, and here is all the level. We see that indeed we get from starting from this ferro state, we get in the resonating balance bound, and at the end we get the correlation we expect. So this, we have a lot of finite size effect because this is really narrow system. But essentially, we saw that the correlation are really going in the sublattice and are essentially the same for the same shape sigma in the for sigma z, sigma z, and sigma x.
But what about decay? So your encoding is one ground on the side of
it? Yeah.
So one.
Okay, so the I encode with one, yeah, one, yes. So indeed, what does it mean? Mean that this is a good point. We need something I don't put in my Hamiltonian, that is the Rydberg decay. But the point is that the nice point of Rydberg is that we can put this all these atoms sufficiently close by that the energy scale associated to this spin flip can be much faster than the decay. That means that you can rely on this system and observe this dynamic for a sufficiently large system and a sufficient long time. So it means essentially that this Rydberg analog simulator have a finite time life in which you can use it. But what matters is the time, the typical time scale you get in your dynamics. Essentially, is how many oscillation, how many periods your system can evolve, and this in a sense it's exactly the same as in the experiment of in Harvard. This is essentially will limit you the number of coherent spin or the total number you can go, but this is still allow you to go to order of 50 spins. So in a sense, this
okay,
is
so you can remain adiabatic and still have a size.
Yes, because in a sense that the Rydberg I did so quite nice because you can configure this spin position. And at the same time, the interactions are so strong that even if they decay, they live long enough. So this is there's always this. So for instance, cold atoms are much more coherent, but the interactions are weaker. So this is one has to pay some price somewhere. But as you observe, it's correct. This wouldn't be possible if this is decaying too fast. So in other words, we have to be sure that this all this energy scale are much higher than the frequency, the gamma. So this, there is no experiment, but this essentially is the experiment that Michel Lukin in Harvard should be able to do now. And this is what we are going for. And okay, so just to see also, we can in the CD approach, we can also see when this approximation is breaking down, because you see, everything here is a matter of energy scale. So this object here is fixed by interactions. So when we adjust this dynamics to be the one we want, this is fixed by the geometry. So if this potential is too big, we cannot get in the resonating violent quantum phase, because it means that we should ramp up our rapid coupling to be too high. But if it's too high, we are breaking the rotating wave approximation. So what we are showing here is that we have before breaking the rotating wave approximation is when essentially this gap to the higher state is closing. We can assess the resonating violent quantum. This is the BBD, we can do all the evolution, and we see that if we get the merging of this correlation before the system starts for one, that when the system starts. So this is a good message. So as I say, this was a work in progress with Benoit Lemaitre, that is in Innsbruck, and Michel. Very interested to get to the lattice gauge theory in the lab. And so what we can do, somehow this we can have with this Rydberg a natural 2D scalable U1 gauge theory. And we can prepare and detect the resonating violent bond in the dual form. In principle, when we have this, we can also extend this duality also when we have charges, and probably we can in principle probe confinement to static charges. Unfortunately, energy is left yesterday, but I think this is his work. So they predict with Monte Carlo calculation this kind of graph, and in principle, one could detect them. And as I said, this one could also consider other charge distribution and boundary condition, and essentially get directly the dual formulation of a container model. And we could have in principle also dynamical charges if they are boson, because we can use the X mechanism with perhaps combining with the new insight from Ignacio, one could also do Fermion, but this is much far away. And then the good message is that we should have the 2D lattice gauge theories in the lab. There are other efforts in which we are working at in getting dynamics. This is also somehow there is a good message for quantum matter, because it seems that we can get a new root for quantum magnetism. Somehow, if we get Rockwell Stevenson frustrated lattice, known that we can get resonating by response to liquid, and this should be in the same essentially class that the anti-ferromagnetic is model. Here, the nice thing is that we could, in principle, we could have the map that is exact, at least in the limit of this rotating wave approximation. And then, from the more general perspective, this amount allowed to get this generalized blockade model. And this generalized blockade model are essentially a quantum version of cellular automata that are also interesting for the for this strange breaking of ergodicity that is observed in the spot. This is what I wanted to tell you. What is top string?
This this lattice model will be like doing e to the I theta sigma z on all the links. Cool lattice. The expectation value of that.
Somehow this is the same in a sense that the idea of proving the confinement is really you put static charges. Now if you do the dual of this. The effect is that essentially, in my background, appear a string that is connecting these two charges. And then, what the dynamics? You can place the string arbitrarily, and then the plaquette will take care of generating all the dynamics on all the allowed states. So, if I have to put the charges, what I have to do? I have to change my state omega. I have to change this one. So here is the state, a good starting state when I have no background charges. If I start putting a charge here and a charge here, I should see in which place I should put a string. So the effect of this is that there will be some plaquette that will be blocked, but all the other configuration will be accessible just by the plaquette dynamics. And essentially what is ending up, and this will change this projector around the place where you put the string. That probably is very similar to what you are saying. And then if you study that dynamic, you get so essentially from the point of view of the rhythm, you have to change the interaction of the spin, because you change in some place keeping the charges, you change the blockade condition.
Can you freeze those charges?
Yeah, if you want to study confinement, you freeze them and then you start looking at different distance and how this game. If in principle with the X mechanism, I can really reabsorb the ground charges and directing the dynamics of the thing. So in principle, one here can do also the dynamical charges. They are also. Their Fermion nets it's more complicated.
So the Ritz-Mankin Bayer-Pons state that you're talking about, I think that is in the same place as the third code. It's a situation and in fact it's an exact map at the exact
point
to the
yeah, this mapping indeed, this is something that was puzzling for quite some time because I was saying how is possible that the eighth vertex is going to the sixth vertex, but indeed, at zero, when you don't have potential, they are identical, but it's not, the map is not exact, it's just in a sense they have in the same universality class. So, this indeed I was thinking a lot about what I was doing is real or not. And then I realized the in a sense, this one is true everywhere. The way in which I approximate it. With the Rydberg, essentially the idea is that I get this, but it's not an easing with all the same, but I calibrate.
So I wanted to ask you that for the toy code, there was also some proposal some time ago to realize also using the Rydberg method. And I wanted to ask you whether this is fundamentally different, and because it's the same, because it's a thin liquid. Also based on Rydberg atoms, mm-hmm. And also so there could be some
I think
an entity in this case with respect to the other one. It's such a way that in this case you can also realize the Oracle.
So I have to say that I haven't looked to that, but Peter didn't suggest me to look to it. But this indeed somehow this just means that from the Richter perspective, this just means that they have to realize an easing and ferro, right? In a sense, if I dualize the toric code, I get the easing antiferro, and therefore the toric code is a bit bad because I remove the all the topological property, but I agree that essentially the kind of phase one is getting in this is the same. And essentially also the people say that if you take now the triangular the easing antiferro and the triangular lattice, this would give the true topological spilliquid again from argument of being in the same universality class. What I understand here is that here I'm doing the math exact, here I'm doing an approximation, but now from the Rydberg point of view, this is much more controlled because the Rydberg has also this nearest neighbor interaction. So indeed one should to check whether which in essence this is an improved Hamiltonian that is converging faster to that or not. This I have to say that we didn't look at that.
I think there's a subtle issue here because actually if you put a duality in the toric code, the bulk you get what you get. But then you have some kind of boundary condition with a dynamic with your topological appearance. And here you're completely lost that.
Yeah, because here I block the boundary. So this could be also another difference. Yes. Indeed. So this is related to the fact, again, if I change my topological background, that means that I change the boundary condition at the border, that means that I start putting some strings that are, remember the one of the two. Now, indeed, you are suggesting that if we have to have the complete picture, I should put that also boundary Hamiltonian. But somehow, the nice point to me is that this was quite surprised. That due to this, one can really have a nice map of the resonant quadrant form that goes to the latter. This is something that I wouldn't sincerely expect.
No more questions? So let's thank Lucio again. One is this one is for